Good afternoon, everybody. Well, good to see you all are wide awake after such a great lunch. My name is Nicol Turner-Lee, and I'm here today to actually conduct a conversation. So as you've noticed, we're imagining right now that we're taking you into the living room of Alfred Liggins' house, because if you're in my house, I don't know, I have a lot of kids. May not be in your room to have this kind of conversation. But we're going to actually talk about entrepreneurship. And just for those of you that are not aware, Alfred is the president and CEO of Radio One, the chairman of TV One, and the CEO of Interactive One. And with those slew of properties, that portfolio of properties, I think there are a couple things that we'll be able to have a great conversation about today, which I think MMTC has particularly asked us to do, which is walking us through this acquisition, due diligence, financing, and actually I want to add ideation process, right? And how do you actually have all these properties and these companies, and how do you really go through that process? So we're going to go into his head today and pick his brain on some of the things I think many of us in this room are interested in, particularly for those of us that come to MMTC every year. We hope to leave with a nugget of knowledge so that we can actually take that back and apply it. So you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. So for the sake of time, I'm not going to go too much into his bio. I'm going to jump right into the questions. And the way that we're going to actually format this is I've actually come up with a series of questions that I would like to ask of him. And if there is time permitting, we will open it up for the audience for additional questions. But as you all know, we're a bit behind in the conference, so we're going to do as much as we can to stay within our time frame. Okay.
Does that mean you want me to be brief in my answers?
No, I'm just trying to. How much time do we have? Okay, so we have about 30 minutes, so I'll be
all
brief
right.
in my
That's
questions,
good.
And you'll be brief in yours. Thank you. So first, Alfred, tell us the story behind the hugely successful Cat Hughes, Alfred Liggins, Radio One Empire. Tell us more about it.
Well, my mother, has a storied background in radio as the first female general manager in Washington, D.C. She ran WHUR, the Howard University radio station. She created the Quiet Storm, and then she married my stepfather, who was in television, a gentleman named Dewey Hughes, and they received an opportunity based on many of the things that you're here discussing at this convention to buy a radio station through a distress sale. A guy named Egmont Sonderling, who's no longer with us now, used to own a bunch of black radio stations. Had some employees at the radio stations that were doing things they weren't supposed to, and they got busted, and so he had an opportunity to either sell it to a minority at a discount or lose the license, and that station was WOL. And so she had left WHUR, wanted to be an entrepreneur, and they competed with 20 other black groups to buy this radio station. And Dewey actually, and this is subject of a movie talked to me, but Dewey used to work for Egmont, and so he had a personal relationship with him, and that's how they got into the radio business. And my story into the radio business isn't as compelling or as doesn't have as much dignity. But the night that they were taking over the radio station at midnight, and I was like 15 years old, I was asleep and I didn't want to get up and go.
Little did you know.
So my start in the radio business was get your butt out of bed and go down here. And that's how I first got into WOL. But that was the start. They're still good friends, but they're no longer married. And then once they split up, I had been out in L.A. Working in the record business, and she convinced me to come back, to help at the radio station. And it just so happens, I said I had been working in the record business, so it just so happened that I was unemployed at the time. So it was a really brilliant idea, as far as I was concerned. And I came back and started out in the sales department, selling, one share Black Talk AM radio. Mm-hmm. And that's how she and I became business partners. Mm-hmm. I was the sales guy that wouldn't leave to go to a larger company, because I would have gotten killed. By that time, she was doing the morning show because she couldn't afford to have anybody else do it. She really positioned WOL and herself as the voice of the black. I figured out a unique way of selling that to white advertising agencies and not let them be offended, you know, because that's where most of the money was, and we didn't have any ratings. And my pitch was, is you're not the audience. It's not for you. This is a specific audience in a very black city, and we should be on your buy. And eventually, we made enough money at that time. And I guess my big contribution was, you know, really, you know, pushing for FM expansion.
Right.
And we started, we bought our first FM WMMJ in 1987 here. And it was, you know, you oftentimes you don't have the opportunity that you want, because another event that happened that you would have been discussing here was GE bought RCA, and they had to spin off a bunch of stuff. And one of those things that I'm sure David, you know, convinced them to spin off was WKYS here. And we were a really small company, and, you know, we wanted to buy it. And, you know, my mother's approach to it at that time was to, you know, create the community committee corporation where the community was going to buy it. Mm-hmm. So she was on the radio telling people, we should buy this radio station, let's raise money. And she would go to, you know, she'd have a meeting in different churches around the city twice a week, and people would show up and they would write checks. Mm-hmm. And she had $500,000 in an account for the community committee corporation. And then a woman who worked at the FCC, SEC, a black woman who was a fan of hers and a listener, called her up and said, look, I just need to pull your coattail. What you're doing is illegal. You can't sell securities on the radio to people who aren't qualified investors. So that was the end of the Community Committee Corporation. So she, but I was stunned that she'd raised $500,000 on the radio. And this was in 19, we bought, it was 19, oh gosh, I don't remember, maybe it was 84 or something like that. But ultimately, we were able to buy a radio station that, at that point in time, you couldn't own 5 FM. So a company called Outlet Communications, which owned WTOP, owned a station, WMMJ, which is 102.3, which is a Class A. And one of the things that you guys might be talking about here is also low-power radio. But it was a low-powered station. They wanted a bigger station. They were buying WASH at 97.1, which was 50,000 watts, and this was 3,000 watts. So they were selling that one, and quite frankly, nobody important or big with a lot of money wanted it. And so we were able to buy it with the help of Terry Jones and Herb Wilkins at Syndicated Communications. And then, you know, our entrepreneurial instincts took over, and, you know, we, you know, created a new format here in Washington, which was a different take on urban radio. It was urban AC, because everybody was playing the same thing, from James Brown to the Sugar Hill Gang, and, you know, it was basically a Motown-based format, and the station took off. And that station that cost $7.5 million 5 years later was actually making $5 million a year. And then we built the rest of the company off of that.
Well, you know, and that's interesting. I think what you're sharing, like these moments of time, and I think that's for all of you all that are entrepreneurs. I used to be told when I was an entrepreneur, when that shade opens, you better jump out real quick because you never know if that's going to be a make or break moment. So what are you most successful about, just on the Radio 1 side? This history, this journey that you've been in, what have you been most successful about with the radio station?
Most successful about or most proud of?
Most proud of, yeah.
To be honest with you, yeah, actually, I'm most proud of the fact that me and my mother have been able to be in business for almost 30 years and stay in business, and there's been no family fracture.
No scandals, reality shows.
Because it ain't easy, right? Like, you know, you got kids, right? And kids working in the business, and they think they know everything. And, you know, so we've been partners a long time, and we both have strong personalities. So I'm most proud of that. Business successes, there have been a bunch of them. I mean, what happened at WMMJ was amazing. What, you know, has happened at TV1, going from, you know, nothing to, you know, $120 million business that, you know, was essentially the second real credible option for black people, you know, was amazing. We've done a bunch of radio deals, you know, that that we're proud of. I've done a bunch of them that I'm not proud of, and I've done a few that I'd love to sell if anybody in here would like to buy some radio stations. So I would say, you know, it's a myriad of things. I think that if she was here, her answer would be, because, you know, she and I are different people, and we have different approaches to why we're in business. And, you know, I have to say that hers first and foremost has always been about informing and educating and creating opportunity for African Americans and women, you know. And she would say it would be all of the people, you know, that she's been able to hire and employ over the years, you know, and give opportunities to.
Talk to me, though, about the TV One piece. I think that's interesting, right? Because you started in radio, and now TV One has created this market share that is very impressive.
Yep.
And you and I were just talking about the original programming that TV One has been coming out with. Who moved the cheese to go from radio
I did. I was the architect. Yeah, I've generally been the architect of the expansion of the company. Now, when you're partners, the architect is, you know, come up with ideas, we sit around and, you know, I pitch him and, you know, I got to get her to agree. I mean, you know, literally in every sense of the word, we're partners, because I used to own, one of the things that I did even while we worked, I actually started my own company. All of our radio stations in Atlanta that we own actually used to be a separate company that I owned. And, you know, I opened up, before we went public, I merged that into Radio One. So, you know, we've been partners, yeah, spiritually, family-wise, and economically a long time. So when you actually have a partner that's got to sign off on something, you know, you have to convince them to go along with it. You know, so every decision, every acquisition, you know, she and I, you know, ultimately agreed on it. But the cable network was definitely, you know, an idea that I spearheaded. I sold radio for so many years, and when you sell advertising, when you sell anything, actually, you get what you call objections. By the way, the smartest clients you've ever come across are the ones that tell you yes, right? You know, when somebody tells you yes, you go, they get it, they really get it, right? And the ones that tell you no, they don't get it. And you know, over time, yeah, I saw a pattern of the ones that were telling me no. They liked television. They liked to see their products, you know, in picture form. And there was something that I couldn't actually combat. And at the time I was watching, you know, BET was the only game in town. I was watching largely music videos. It was, you know, lots of infomercials, et cetera. You know, there was a particular void in the black community that, you know, those of us who were, you know, in the media, you know, heard from our listeners, consumers, and knew it had to be filled. It was just really impossible to fill it, because the way the cable industry works is it's controlled by a few companies, and one of those companies happened to be partnered with Bob, you know, TCI, and they were the largest cable operator, and unwilling to actually entertain, you know, giving anybody else any carriage. But that ultimately changed, and Bob sold, and AT&T, and then TCI sold, and then Comcast was the new big dog, and they were more open to the conversation. And by that time, Radio One was public, yeah, and we had access to a lot of funds, you know, a good size market cap, so we were able to come to the party not just with an idea, but with the vast majority of the money. I mean, you know, Comcast was our partner in it, but we put up $74 million for TV One. They put up 15, and I raised the rest from, you know, some venture capital sources, a couple of people that have come out of the minority arena that were in business with us in Radio One, and one new big, you know, traditional venture capital fund. So to come to the party with an idea and the money, you know, you put up the distribution, you know, the big argument, you know, for a period of time was who would control the network, and because they like to control a lot of their stuff, but I was like, well, we're kind of putting up most of the money, so I think it should be us. You know what I mean? Forget the fact that we're black and it's a black network. So I led with the argument that it's our money, you know? And that's what happened, and it worked out, you know?
Well, before we go to interactive ones, so let's just assume that some of us in this room don't have the capital that you probably had to actually do the bartering. So
yep.
What do you say to folks out there that have those same types of ideas? And I think what you opened up is there was the possibility again.
Yeah, I mean, look, I don't know. I'm not, you know, completely familiar with the intimate details, but from what I'm hearing, Comcast has launched these new diversity networks, and you know, the Magic Network and the Puffy Network, you know, they're bringing in investors. I mean, I don't think Magic or Puffy are writing individual checks, right? I know one of the venture capital funds that was in TV1 is actually invested in, you know, Gospel Music Channel and Aspire, and I think that the Diddy Channel is going to get financed similarly. Now, they're celebrities, so people want to be in business with them. We're regular people. You know, they got to really love our idea, or it's got to be a super, super deal for them. So it's completely 1,000 times harder for you or me to raise money, you know. But the fact of the matter is when we bought WMMJ, we raised money. We weren't celebrities. When we ultimately bought the end of that the original WKYS story is we ultimately did get to buy WKYS, but you know, by that time we'd figured out how to finance it, and I was able to bring outside money, non-minority oriented money, meaning that it wasn't, you know, an SSBIC or a MESBIC or any fund that was focused on financing minorities, and it was based on the merits of we were buying our competitor. We had a decent price, and we had a track record, and we thought that we could make the returns work for them.
Right.
And so I would tell you that there is money available. And, you know, I've sat on panels a lot. I'm not saying that it's easy to come by, but there's a lot of money out there. And the hard part, you know, is, you know, finding the right investor that believes in your idea, and more importantly, believes that you can actually execute that idea, because everybody's got a great idea. And, you know, it comes down to execution. In fact, many people have the same great idea, because when there's voids in the marketplace, you're not the first and only person to identify that void. You know, it wasn't like, you know, right. When we created TV1, it was some secret that there could be a second black television channel, right? You know, and so I would tell you that, you know, spending your time, A, finding the most compelling opportunity that you can, and then thinking about how you're going to pitch it to somebody from the perspective of what's in it for them, right? Why should they be certain that you're going to be able to get them a return? Because ultimately what you're asking them to do is put up all the money and give you equity in it for your idea.
So let's talk about Interactive One then, right? Because when you look at Interactive One and what you've done there, it sounds like with Radio One and TV One, you had an opportunity to sort of form this idea.
Yep.
Under Interactive One, and for those of you that are not familiar, kind of share with them, Alfred, what that is. Yeah. But you've got other properties that have been out for a while.
Yeah, so Interactive One, so we were in radio, we needed a picture, you know, BET only in town, so we create TV One, and that's going well. And then, you know, the internet happened, which I'm still pissed about, you know what I mean? And anybody who's in the traditional media business should be pissed, okay? Yeah. And I tried to ignore it for a while. In fact, I refused to be on email for the first 5 years that everybody else was on email. But then ultimately it clicks that, okay, it is a distribution system that is unlike any other because it's two-way. Not only do you send information and content out, it comes back, you interact. So now not only do you have the opportunity to show people your content, you have the opportunity to transact and do business with them. You know, so instead of just selling advertising to Walmart or General Motors, you could actually be in the business where you could collect a fee, a service, you know, a toll, or, you know, a margin on e-commerce, and you started to see how much usage was going to the internet, but more important, and why I got into it, is you started to track ad dollars. So, you know, the unfortunate part about this, and I don't know, you know, Sherman, if you've talked about it with anybody, but the radio business hadn't grown its revenue since like 2004. Forget, actually maybe it was 2000, maybe it was 2003, forget 2008 and 2009 when the world ended. I think Bear Stearns went bankrupt in May of 2008, Lehman crashed, you know, that fall. But the radio business had basically been flat up until then. So you were getting share shift. Money was going to the cable interconnect. But the fastest growing part of the pie was the internet. It was just moving, you know, at a rapid pace. And the fact of the matter is advertisers, marketers were not creating, they weren't adding those dollars to their budget, they were moving it from other places. So as, you know, a person who sells advertising and you see that your base business, which has historically grown at 8% a year for the last 30 years, and we used to pitch it to Wall Street, you know, on average, radio had grown 8% a year for 30 years, huge toward growth. Well, for the last 5 years, hasn't grown at all. You know, you realize that you had to come up with a position, you know, in the online advertising space to draw advertising for your particular, for your niche. The opportunity that we saw was that, like, you know, all distribution systems, you know, the ethnic verticals grew last. So there really wasn't a dominant player serving up African-American content online. BET launched BET.com. They were the first guys out there to do it. And they were early, and being early is oftentimes a problem because the market's not developed. It's hard to sell people things that they're not ready to buy yet, you know, things that they don't want. It's tough to sell them. And so they were early, and by the time we decided to get into it, there was still an opportunity. And so we created iOn. We allocated, again, we're a public company, so we had resources. So we allocated $30 million to build, you know, essentially a business that would be a collection of original content sites. It would be an ad sales force, an ad operations force, a technology team to build these websites. We contemplated building affiliate networks or selling advertising for other entities, and we were going to go after the space. And we did that, and then one of the main competitors in the space, a company called Community Connect, which owned a social network called Black Planet, which many of you are familiar with, decided to sell. And we were kind of faced with a decision as to whether to buy it or risk somebody else buying it and having to compete against them. You know, originally we were going to pass because they wanted, you know, some ridiculous amount of money, and then and the auction was busted, meaning that they didn't get what they wanted. So, you know, when it came down to a more reasonable price, or what we thought was reasonable, $35 million, we ended up buying it, and we put those two entities together, and we became number one in the space in terms of audience size right away. Then we went into the downturn. Mm-hmm. So you start a brand new company, you know, and in a tough business to be with that's fragmented, and then the world ends economically, and then you're sitting there fighting your radio business going down 20% a quarter for almost four quarters in a row. You're carrying a lot of debt. So you spend 3 years kind of bailing water out of the boat, but at the same time knowing that you got to feed Interactive One because it's the future, because all the while that traditional media was getting hammered, online advertising was still going up
all through the recession. On the online space, so I've heard media analysts talk about Facebook and Twitter and these other places that are galvanizing the advertising model, though. So what impact are you having on those things? Because I know, you know, radio was pretty clear-cut model for advertising, advertising revenue. Now, the internet consumer is not a consistent consumer, right? And they pretty much are all over the board. They're myriad of interests.
So yeah, one of your questions was, is like, you know, what's, you know, what do you deal with? Like, you know, why is it tough? And the internet is incredibly difficult because it changes every year. Right. Every year there's some new technology, some new take on it. When we bought Black Planet, you know, I sort of, my pitch to my board was, hey, Rupert Murdoch bought MySpace when it had this much, you know, audience, and the value exploded, and he's going to use his traditional media assets to help grow that, and look how smart that was. We need to do the same thing for African Americans, and this art only, he paid $600 million, we're gonna pay 35. What a great deal, right? Yeah. Well, what Rupert didn't see and what we didn't know about is the rise of Facebook, mm-hmm. right? I mean, you know, who knew that Facebook was going to come in and unseat, you know, essentially all other social networks as the primary institutional social infrastructure for the world. And, you know, Black Planet's traffic got cut in half. Now, fortunately, before that happened, we were able to use Black Planet and that audience, which is still large. When I say got cut in half, it got cut in, you know, from 2 million monthly users to 1 million monthly users, still a good-sized business. But we were able to launch all of our content verticals off of it. So when we bought Black Planet and we launched News One, then all of these people online knew that there was a Black News, you know, site out there. When we launched Hello Beautiful, they knew that there was a new Black women's site because we had it all threading through. And each of those brands, News One, Hello Beautiful, and the Urban Daily, are each million user brands on a monthly basis on their own. So it did help us build, you know, our content verticals. But it changed. So now, so you have the rise of Facebook, right? And then you have then the rise of Twitter. You know, who would think that, you know, Twitter would be a competitor, you know, to Facebook? And now the next thing that even Twitter and Facebook are dealing with is the rise of the smartphone, yeah. because advertising works great right. when you're sitting in front of a nice screen on your desktop and you can, you know, mouse around and click on this video and that, you know, banner, etc. You put it on this screen, it's not so effective anymore, right? And it's hard to monetize. And it's just stuff just like that keeps on going. Facebook just had to deal with Instagram. I've never even been on Instagram, but a bunch of people, you know, were, and they were scared enough of it to pay $1 billion for it. You know, so it changes so fast, you know, that it's hard to know. It's very hard to have a vision, stick to it, lead your team, and then when you have to pivot without seeming like you're abandoning the mission. You know, because, you know, it's one thing to, you know, you can lead people and you can, you know, change direction, but there's a fine line between doing that and also being seen as indecisive and not having a mission and not standing for anything. So that's, you know, that's the challenge of the internet.
So where do you see, I mean, I actually have to say, when you held up that phone, I kept thinking in a couple of years, when you come back next year, we'll have the interactive one mobile device that will actually bring all your properties together.
Yeah.
But where do you see, I mean, on that note, as an entrepreneur, what's next, right? Because it sounds like in the evolution of your portfolio, it's been around these open needs, right? So where do you see it's going next? If to give us some seed of knowledge of what we need to look forward to in this industry.
Look, at you know, my own personal, you know, view for my company, because I can't count before, if you owned a radio station, wow, there's only 20 FM radio stations in Washington, D.C. You got a safe market. Now I'm not even so sure that you're going to have AM and FM on the dashboard in a car in 5 years. So who cares if you have a stick? Now, there's a long way in between the stick not mattering, you know what I mean, and they're not, you know, being, you know, a five-button preset, you know, in the car. And just because there's not a five-button preset in the car doesn't mean that the WKYS brand, which still comes off the tower on Nebraska Avenue, you know, doesn't mean something in that new digital world. But I'm not quite sure how the distribution systems are actually going to play out. I don't know, and you've heard this probably, you know, from your cable friends, but I'm not so sure how willing, you know, 10 years from now, cable operators are going to be to pay big license fees to content, you know, creators. Like, you know, right now there's a big issue with Viacom and DirecTV. DirecTV's pushing back. Viacom says, you're not going to take my channels. Their ratings are down 30%. It's an incredible Mexican standoff, you know, now. I don't know who gets hurt more. I guess we'll find out, you know. They'll come to a deal, but, you know, but that's the tension that you're dealing with. So, so from my standpoint, and you know, as a company, you know, the safer haven that we've got to get to is really becoming a real content creator. In radio, you don't really create content. The record companies create your content, and you dress it up, and you find DJs who most of the time annoy you, right? You know, but sometimes you're lucky enough to find some very talented ones that entertain you, but they're few and far between. And so, you know, what, you know, what you have to become and you can in television and the web is, you know, the creator, you know, of visual or text, you know, content consistency that you can own and then monetize across the different platforms, whatever it is, whether it's the tablet, whether it's actually, you know, a transmitter, you know, for a radio station. What I love about the internet is now my radio stations actually become video vehicles, right? Because I can tell you, you know, you can watch a video on this. You could listen to my radio station and you could watch a simultaneous video, you know, on it. And that makes me a different media vehicle. So we're plowing money into content. We're doubling the number of original hours on TV One. We're talking about launching more content verticals at I1. We're looking at M&A opportunities. Are there any competitors that, you know, we could buy that might make sense? Because where I1 is at in its gestation period is it's probably about a $23 or $24 million business now. But believe it or not, that's a break-even business, you know, because it costs a lot of money, you know, to build these things and to hire great people. You can be a small, scrappy entrepreneur, which I would suggest, and you can run it, you know, out of your living room, and you can get traffic. You can get a couple million users, you know. But ultimately, if you're going to scale the business, you got to hire people. Like Twitter makes no money, you know, today, right? You know, And so I1's at that point where we're breaking even. And now if we start to layer on more audience, we can use our existing infrastructure. If we start creating more content, we can monetize it. And that's where I think the future is. And also, whatever the distribution systems are, even the internet is supposedly free to us to access. But the big battle is net neutrality, whether or not Comcast and, you know, Verizon are going to ultimately choke off who gets through and in what time. So, you know, it's not completely liberating, right? You know, and there will be ways where people who have Google, you know, for example, everybody thinks, I don't know if everybody thinks this, but people, I don't know if people realize the main reason Google got into the cell phone business and they created Android, which they don't make any money off of because they give it away to cell phone providers free, is because they wanted to make sure that every time you went to search on your cell phone, because you were going to search on your cell phone, you searched with them and not Yahoo and not MSN. You know, so even the big companies are going to try to find ways to constrict, you know, little competitors from coming up, you know, but you have an opportunity to get in, own an audience, own an idea, own a service, build some mass, and you can either sell it or then at least once you get, you know, some success, then raising money becomes much easier because that's what all these Silicon Valley startups, you know, do. They go out and say, look, I just went to 20 million monthly users in a year. Who does that? Okay, you know, we're making $50,000, you know, a month, you know, but, you know, that's not the story. The story is the growth. The idea must be here. So somebody give me $50 million at a $500 million valuation.
All right. Okay, I sucked out one question because I think we could probably have stayed here longer actually talking about this, don't you think?
Yeah.
Before we go to a question, I think one of the greatest things that we actually heard, and we do want to applaud you for the work that you all are doing and what your mom and you have put together, is this whole hear it, see it, touch it, and be aware of what's next. And I think that's a great kernel for us to leave with here at MMTC. Okay, so I have time for one question. You need to make it brief, and we need to make the response.
You talk to me all the time.
Right. Okay, so somebody who doesn't talk to him all the time, I'll take that moderator privilege.
You asked me five in the hallway.
Right, somebody didn't ask him in the hallway. Okay, we'll go to this guy back here.
I have a quick question, Mr. Liggins, great presentation. It seems like, I know you've told the story a million times, but it sounds very fresh today. Thank you for sharing. When someone comes to you with a business plan, their own idea, and they say, oops, here we go, talking to Mike. When someone comes to you with a business plan, their own idea, they're pitching to you about how they can help you to expand your potential, do you ask them to give you specific numbers? Because a lot of times those numbers don't turn out to be true, they're fantasy.
Yeah, well, that's a good question. Because people see us with a platform, and everybody has an idea that they think's gonna help us, right? Some people might, okay, but you also have to remember that A, you know, a lot of people come with those ideas. B, we're sitting around the office all day thinking of ways to help ourselves, okay? But most importantly, one of the things that's a fault in business plans, and this has happened around, the latest thing was a debit card, okay? Because everybody's launching them. You got the Rush card, BET's launching one, Univision's got one. So we've been getting a bunch of proposals in about debit cards, and all of the proposals were, you can make $20 million a year because you can get all of these like users and you've got the advertising base, et cetera, et cetera. And it was fiction. And you know, we're interested in the debit card area. We just launched a test to see how well our platform performs with a debit card. We did it with this company called Plastique and Visa. But we had to do a bunch of research, you know, to realize that the opportunity wasn't anywhere near $20 million a year. In fact, none of these people that were actually already doing it were doing those kinds of numbers. But I got at least three proposals from people on the outside looking for an opportunity that had access to me, right? So once they got to me and they put something on the table that was completely not, you know, real fiction, and it hurt their credibility, you know. So, you know, I would say the answer is I do, and that's the quickest way not to get a second hearing for your next idea, because those people didn't do their research on the industry. If they had walked in and actually enlightened me so I wouldn't have to have done as much research, or when I did the research I found out that they were right, I'd probably be doing business with them, because let them do the work. They had, you know, they've got the idea, they've got the interest, they're looking for the opportunity, but you wouldn't do business with them because, you know, they weren't thorough enough to actually assess the real, you know, marketplace in the first place.
All right, let's thank Alfred Liggins for presenting.
Thank you. Thank you very much.